Hi everybody, welcome to today's webinar, Improving the Quality of Hire with the McQuaig System. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Vanessa Vasilikaris. I work here at McQuaig as a resource consultant. And today I'm going to be your guide as we look at some of the challenges that a lot of our clients tell us they have in the hiring process, and also how McQuaig can help address those challenges. So I'd like to start off with a quote. This is from Jim Collins, author of Good to Great. He tells us that people are not our greatest asset. It's the right people who are. And a big part of today is talking about how can we go about making sure we get the right people on the bus. So our customers tell us that they have a number of challenges when they're hiring. They tell us that one of the challenges is that they have several stakeholders that need to agree on who the right person is for a particular job. Some of the stakeholders have their own individual processes and practices for hiring people. Even though sometimes those practices might be sound, and sometimes not so sound, they may not be consistent with other people in the process chain. And a lot of this comes down to people having often very different assumptions about what is important in the job itself and in a candidate for the job. Differing assumptions about what matters can lead people to make very different decisions about all kinds of things. And certainly different decisions about who the best person is to fill a particular role. This makes things particularly challenging because the cost of hiring the wrong person is so high. Some statistics out there say that the cost can be as much as 3 times that person's annual salary. Other statistics out there would say that the 3 times is actually a conservative estimate. Another problem with inconsistent views and practices is that differences in understanding about what's important in a job and about the person who should do the job can shine through in the employee themselves. And if you've actually found the right person for the job, they may say to themselves, "This place seems a little bit schizophrenic. I want out of here." And that is potentially even more costly in terms of opportunity cost than hiring the wrong person. Some of our clients always talk about the challenges of ensuring that managers are onboarding and developing their new employees in a way that's going to help them get involved, feel motivated, and want to stay. Research out there shows that within the first 6 months of an employee's life cycle, those 6 months are critical. In that time, that's when they make a decision about whether or not they're going to stay with an organization for the long term, or if they want to start planning their escape. So for those that do stay and become your superstars, a challenge can arise when it's time to promote them into another role. Will it work, or will that shooting star become a falling star just because the new job isn't a match for that valued individual? I think we all know about that superstar salesperson who became a miserable sales manager. And finally, what about those people that you don't hire? These people might be your future customers. How do you create a positive experience so that your brand is not damaged in the marketplace? Before we look at what we're going to cover today in the webinar, I actually want to ask you all what some of your challenges have been. So I'm going to put a poll out there to you. Okay, so you should see the poll on your screen now. Go ahead and tick off what challenges you've noticed in your organization, please. Thank you. Okay, I'll give this just a few more seconds. I see most of you have weighed in already. Okay, so it looks like most of you have, I'm going to share the poll results. I believe you should be able to see them now. A lot of you identified the cost of hiring the wrong person, as well as onboarding, development, appropriate promotion as some of your key challenges, but also inefficient, inconsistent hiring practices, cost of turning over the right person, and creating a positive candidate experience do play in there. So today our objective really is to help you address all of those challenges and thereby improve the quality of your hires. What we're going to look at specifically, we're going to talk a little bit about what exactly we should assess in order to be finding the right candidates and strong hires. We're going to talk a bit about what exactly is it that we are looking for, so getting that common agreement. And then are we evaluating all of our candidates through the same lens? If we're not, then it's no surprise we're not getting the quality of hire that ideally we would like. We'll talk about how to get the straight goods from a candidate, so as you're speaking and interviewing them, how to really assess them to make sure that you're getting some valuable information. And then, now that you've got them, how are you going to keep them? We're going to talk about how McQuaig can help you in each one of these areas. So I want to start out with this slide. This speaks a little bit to the predictive power of different selection procedures out there. So if we take you back to Stats 101, what we're looking here at are correlations. So at the very top line, we see flipping a coin. If that's the method we're using to assess our candidates, that's completely random selection. That's going to carry a correlation of 0. At the bottom there, we see a correlation of 1.0. That's perfect. We choose the right candidate 100% of the time. Maybe we have a crystal ball that's telling us all the answers. I don't have that crystal ball, and I don't think you do either, so most of us need to rely on the methods that are listed in between these two. You can see close to the top, just under flipping a coin, is the traditional unstructured interview. And isn't that scary? It comes in just a little bit higher than a coin flip. And it's worth it to note, actually, that that's probably the most common interviewing practice out there. And in most interviews, a decision is made based on just a traditional unstructured interview. Below that, and this might be surprising to some of you, we see that references, they're actually more predictive than an unstructured interview, coming in at about a 0.35 correlation. Below that, biographical data, so they're what you see on their resume, basically, their background and history. Obviously, that's important and telling. Even higher, though, are personality tests, like the McQuaig system, the McQuaig Word Survey, as well as intelligence and ability tests. And we're not going to touch on it too much today, but McQuaig does have an assessment available, if any of you are interested in learning more, that does capture elements of intelligence and ability. Work sample tests, also quite predictive, as is the structured behavioral interview. A lot of people involved in hiring just don't know how to conduct strong interviews. If we interview well, then our structured behavioral interview will actually be fairly predictive of whether or not that individual is gonna be the right hire. The items that you see highlighted on this slide here, references, personality tests, intelligence, ability, and structured behavioral interview, these are all items that McQuaig can assist you with and assist you in doing them strongly. If we use a combination of these methods and we use them well, we can actually increase our batting average to about a 0.7. That's pretty good, coming from the 0.19 of the traditional unstructured interview. So a key point of this slide that I do want you to walk away with is not simply to rely on an interview, is to do just that, is to combine the structural behavioral-based interview with reference checks, a McQuaig word survey, and potentially even the McQuaig occupational test, which is the intelligence ability test that we have available. So let's look at what it is that we assess when we meet with candidates or we meet with people in life. There was a study done by Princeton University that concluded in just 100 milliseconds of meeting somebody, people start making decisions about you based on just your face. Things like your attractiveness, that makes a lot of sense. You tell that pretty quickly. But we also start making assumptions on things like a person's likability, their competence, their trustworthiness, aggressiveness, etc. We call those that level of assessment level one assessment. This is what somebody appears to be. Things that are captured in this level of assessment are things like appearance, mannerisms, expressiveness, interests, presence. A lot of these things are important on the job. Certain jobs do call for somebody that has a certain presence to them. But what's important for us to avoid doing here is to start making those assumptions that actually are quite natural for us to make, and we need to be cognizant of that. It's not going to be surprising for you all to hear that level one assessment carries the lowest predictive ability of on-the-job performance. So how else do we assess people? The second level of assessment is all about who you are, your skills and abilities. If the job task at hand is swimming in a race, a cow and a dolphin bring pretty different abilities to the table. So level two assessment, this is all about knowledge and acquired skills, training, experience, education. Not surprisingly at all, this does have a much higher predictive ability of on-the-job performance. However, if you think about it, these are all things that we can actually gather from somebody's resume. We actually don't even really need to meet them in order to get an understanding of this information. And I'm sorry, this slide is mistitled. The third level of assessment is all about why you are who you are. Your temperament is part of that. Your temperament is your natural disposition, you can think of it as. The third level of assessment has by far the highest predictive ability of on-the-job performance, and it looks like at things like positive attitude, internal motivation, persistence, determination, mature character, aptitude, intelligence, and temperament, which is measured by McQuaig. Something that's unfortunate is level three assessment, it actually tends to be the most difficult for us to get to and to assess. I'm going to actually put another poll out there to you, and I'd like to know which level would you say that your organization's hiring managers rely most heavily on when hiring someone? And you should be able to see that on your screen now. I'll give it a few moments for you all to chime in. Okay, I see most of you voted. I'll just wait a couple more seconds just for give the rest of you a chance to chime in, then we'll close the poll. Okay. All right, we've closed the poll. I'm going to share the results with you. And I'm actually not surprised by this. The vast majority of you said that your hiring managers and people who hire within your organization do rely pretty heavily on level two assessment. For the 25% of you who are getting to the level three characteristics, you're doing a great job. And for the 17% of you who are relying on level one, I hope you're going to walk away today and have some knowledge to give to your hiring managers and maybe slap them on the wrist a little bit, because we do not want to hire based on level one. I'm going to hide this so you should be able to see my screen again. So this is kind of an overused analogy, but it actually is a fitting one here. Much like your poll results indicate, most interviewers rely very heavily on level one and level two assessment. It's what's above the surface, it's what we see in the interview, it's what's easily accessible to us. It's that level three, that's what you get on the job. That tends to be the reason that people are either promoted or terminated, and it's the most difficult to assess. You really do need to get beneath the surface and get a little bit more in depth with a person in order to look at these characteristics. One way to do that is through McQuaig word survey. Another way is through strong behavioral interviewing, potentially an aptitude test or a work sample, etc. Right? So what's the point of all this? What's the point of the level three assessment? The goal is to hire a natural. Michael Phelps provides us with a good analogy of what we're trying to achieve here with level three assessment. He's an accomplished athlete, so no doubt he puts hours upon hours of work and practice into his sport. But putting that aside, let's look at a few facts about this world-class athlete. He's 6'4", which in itself is an asset to a swimmer. Most people's arm span is exactly the same length as their height, and you can try that at home. For most people, this is true. But Michael Phelps' arm span is 6'7", so he has a 1.5-inch advantage on each arm, and obviously your arms are very important in swimming. So again, we said he's 6'4", but he has the upper body of a man who's 6'8". Massive strength to pull him through the water, and a lower body of a man who's 5'10", so a lot less drag through the water. He's got a size 14 foot, great for kicking, and he's double jointed in each ankle, also great for kicking. So you might not be hiring people for physical fit, but you can hire people for a temperamental fit, which in the world of work is equally important. So that's our goal. We want to hire a Michael Phelps. We want to hire a natural. So let's talk about how McQuaig measures temperament and our four trait scales. The McQuaig system is designed to help you assess those level three characteristics. Psychologists today, they widely agree on what they call the big five personality factors that make up our temperament. McQuaig measures those five factors within four trait scales. And this is a graphical summary of those trait scales. I'm going to discuss each one of them briefly. But first, just looking at the graph itself, you'll notice a bolded line close to the center of the graph. We refer to that as the 42 line because it falls at the number 42, so not a very original name. But what that line represents is a midpoint. Our research has shown that 50% of the population will score above that point, and 50% of them will score below that point on any given trait. Anybody who scores above that midpoint on a given trait scale will be associated with the trait listed at the top. Anybody who scores below will be associated with the trait listed along the bottom. The further away from the midpoint that somebody scores, the more pronounced that trait will be, and the more behaviors you're going to observe that have to do with that trait in their behavior. Okay, so let's look at what these traits actually are. In red here, we call this the power trait. People who are dominant, scoring above the midpoint, they're goal-oriented. They take risks and seek challenges and recognition. They're competitive. They're willing to take charge. More so, sometimes they will insist on taking charge. Individuals who score below the midpoint are accommodating. They're more concerned with the success of the team rather than personal success. They're accommodating team players, consensus seeking. The next trait, it represented in green here, we call this the sociable analytical trait scale. On this, the people trait scale, individuals who score above the midpoint, that 42 line, they're sociable, they're people-oriented, they're empathetic, they like working with others, they like building relationships, getting to know the people they're working with. On the other side of the coin, analytical people, those who score below the 42 line, they're much more fact-oriented, more data-driven. It's not that analytical people don't like people, they very well might, but they're not likely to take the feelings of others into consideration like a sociable person would when they're making a decision. They're going to make their decisions based on the facts and the figures. Next, represented in blue, we have the relaxed driving trait scale. We call this one the pace trait scale. Somebody who scores above the 42 line is considered relaxed. These people are patient and steady. They like to plan ahead. They're deliberate in their actions. One thing I want to highlight on this trait scale, in business, we often view the word relaxed as a negative word. I'm sure none of you have ever written that word into one of your job postings. In McQuaig language, it's not negative. There's no good or bad when it comes to different traits people have that make up their personality. Any trait is going to come with a set of strengths and a possible set of potential weaknesses. Being somebody who is relaxed, it's not that they're not lazy. It's not, you can't make that assumption. They're planners, though. They like to be able to plan ahead and structure their day. Whereas somebody who is driving, these people deal much better with curveballs that if they're thrown their way. These people are restless. They have a high sense of urgency. They're very change-oriented, energetic. They like variety. Okay. Finally, we've got the compliant independent trait scale. This one we call the rules trait. People who score above the 42 line, they're considered compliant. They're detail-oriented, work well within guidelines. They've got a very high regard for established processes, and they'll often follow them to a T. Those who fall below the midpoint, these people are considered independent. They don't necessarily disregard all the rules, but they will question them if they see a better way. They often will do it their way. They're strong-minded. They enjoy having freedom of action. Okay? So what we're going to do now that we've talked a little bit about how McQuaig looks at temperament, what temperament is, and how we measure it, we're going to look at the McQuaig system, and it really is a three-step process. Step one is to define the roles within our organization that we're hiring for, and we do that using the McQuaig job survey. There's actually two parts to the McQuaig job survey. The first is a job analysis, and this is likely something that you already have internally a process for. Really what the job analysis form is, it's just a guide to walk you through a conversation that needs to happen to help you to really determine and agree upon what are the level one, two, and three characteristics that are required for this position I'm hiring for. Once you've determined that and you've got a lot of agreement between your stakeholders who are hiring for this position, then you can go on and complete the McQuaig job survey. This is an example of the first three questions in the McQuaig job survey. It basically asks us to indicate success in this job requires somebody who, and we're ranking these items A, B, C, D. You would have actually each stakeholder in the organization, each person who really knows the position well, you'd have each one of them complete one of these. And once they have, you'll have an idea of the right profile that would be required, the right temperament that would be required for that given position. There's three methods we use to creating a strong job survey benchmark that we're going to hire to. The first is the individual method, and this is probably or definitely the fastest way. In this scenario, you would ask the manager of the role you're hiring for to complete the McQuaig job survey. You'd then use that as your benchmark. One of the positive things about this method is that it's quite fast. One of the drawbacks, though, is if we're only asking for one person's opinion, we run the risk of the potential for bias to be included in those results. So maybe a little bit better would be the stakeholder method. And this I described a little bit. In this method, we would actually ask all of the key stakeholders that are hiring for this position would ask each one of them to take a McQuaig job survey. The people that you would want involved are the people who really have a deep understanding of the day-to-day realities of the role. You don't necessarily want to involve anybody that doesn't. So in some organizations, what that means is that human resources might not be the best person to complete a job survey. While they understand the role at a high level, they might not understand the day-to-day realities. It's not true for all organizations, but it's true for many. Finally, if you have a large department size, you can actually do a top performer study to create the McQuaig benchmark that you're going to hire to. You probably want a fairly large sample size in this case, just to make sure that if there's an outlier that doesn't throw off all of our data. But if you do have, let's say you have a very large inside sales department, well, let's go ahead and survey our top 10% with a McQuaig word survey. We'll look at our bottom 10%, and let's do a little bit of analysis. And from there, we can usually arrive at a pretty strong behavioral benchmark that's really going to help us when we're hiring new people. Okay. Now, this is a sample of what you'll see as a graphical representation once a McQuaig job survey has been completed. In this case, this came from my sample database, and this is a profile for a systems analyst. We can see that our ideal systems analyst would be somebody who's accepting, who's analytical, who's relaxed and compliant. The gray T-bars that you see showing up there, that represents the range in which, if I compare this profile to a candidate profile, that shows me the range in which I'm going to consider them a strong match if they fall within. Okay? Most McQuaig profiles, we can separate them into two major groups with some differences in those groups. This here is what we call a classic specialist profile. The key things that define this as a specialist profile are the red and yellow bars, so somebody accepting and compliant. There's different kinds of specialists, and you might see that the green and blue bar on different sides of the graph, but with the accepting, compliant, the sort of individual that you're going to see in a specialist, somebody who's organized, structured, accurate, analytical, steady, detail-oriented, consensus-seeking. As you're building your McQuaig job profiles, you're going to find that this is what a lot of your subject matter experts are going to look like, much like our IT analyst on the previous slide. These people like to specialize, okay? The opposite of that, the other profile type you're going to see, is somebody who is dominant as well as independent. There may be some differences with the green and blue bars, but this profile type is somebody who is assertive, they're persuasive, driving, big picture thinker, independent, high sense of urgency, decisive. You're going to see this as a profile type when you're doing job surveys. This is going to emerge when you're looking for leaders within your organization, when you're looking for salespeople within your organization. These people they like to generalize. They look at the big picture, whereas our specialists, they prefer to look at the details. So those are the two major profile types that you should be aware of. So the dominant independent is the generalist, and the accepting compliant is the specialist. So when you complete a McQuaig job survey, you get more than just that graph. You actually get a lot of information. The profile is going to give you that visual picture of the specified temperament or behavior pattern for the role that you're defining. There will be as well an interpretation report that will be an overview of the expectations for high performance in this job, along with specific behavioral factors, potential considerations, also some resume screening tips. The leadership profile is a section of the report that you can include if this happens to be a leadership position. It'll be an overall summary of the leadership requirements for the position, followed by a breakdown of how candidates should approach motivating, team building, decision making, problem solving, leading change. Next, the selling style report. Again, this one's optional if it's relevant for the role. It's an overall summary of the behavioral requirements for a sales position, followed by a breakdown of how a candidate should approach prospecting, presenting, and closing. Next, we have a number of interviewing questions. These are behavioral-based interview questions that are specifically customized based on the benchmark or the job profile that you put together using that survey. These can be helpful to you because we're going to have this before we even start recruiting. We're going to have defined our position. So these interview questions can be helpful to you in the screening process because they are customized to the role. And then we've got reference checking questions included in the McQuaig job survey. This, a lot of our clients find very helpful because, and I know I've been guilty of this in the past as well, I think it's all too common for us to regard references as more of an administrative task that we have to do. Our decision's already made up, but oh gosh, we need to do some references. And I know from personal experience, by doing that, we're really missing out on getting some valuable data. So included in the job survey are behavioral-based reference checking questions, customized based on the profile that we put together to help you ask some strong questions of the people that your candidate provides as references, strong questions that are going to give you some meaningful information back. So now that we've defined what we're looking for in a candidate, we can actually begin to assess our candidates. And that's step two of the McQuaig system. I want to start by looking at some common interview questions. If these questions are part of your interviewing repertoire, I'd like you to immediately throw them away. These are not strong interviewing questions. They will not differentiate a level talent for you. Instead, we want to replace these dud questions with behavioral-based interviewing questions. We want to ask for specific examples of how a candidate has demonstrated job-related behavior in the past. These questions are very often going to start with, "Tell me about a time." Instead of the dud questions on the previous slide, we should be asking behavioral-based interviewing questions. And here's a few examples of strong interviewing questions. The McQuaig system can help you with your structured behavioral-based interview. The job survey contains interview questions that are relevant based on the job profile you determined was required for the role you're recruiting for. And the McQuaig word survey, which we're going to ask our candidates to complete, it's going to be sent to all potential candidates, and their responses will give us insight into their temperament. It's also going to provide you with more behavioral interview questions based on their individual temperament. Now, when you administer a McQuaig word survey, your candidate's going to be asked two sets of questions, each containing 21 questions. The first question set asks the individual completing the survey to describe themselves as they think other people see them. The second question set asks them to describe themselves as they really are. So tell me who you really are. This is going to lead to a graphical summary of their responses that'll look something like this. So on the left, the situational side of the graph, that relates to the first set of questions. and it's representative of how the individual is currently behaving on the job. So we're actually finding out how they're behaving on the job by asking them a tricky sort of question, saying, how do you think other people perceive you? On the real side, on the right, this shows somebody's natural temperament. This is the way that they would behave without any outside influence. Very often, you're going to see a lot of agreement between the two graphs, but sometimes you may notice, as the case is here now, an arrow appearing on the situational side. And what that arrow indicates is just that the individual is behaving in a way that is outside of their natural temperament. When those arrows do appear, it's not necessarily a good or bad thing. It's just something worth learning a little bit more about. So in this case, we've got somebody who's quite accepting, but they're behaving more dominantly than is natural for them. Behaving in a way that's outside of our natural temperament it can be stressful. And that's why when we're recruiting, it is quite relevant to see this information. If we see changes from their natural temperament that they're demonstrating right now, we'd like to find out why that's happening and to determine if they're going to have to do that on the job in our roles as well. Okay. A good analogy to behaving outside of your natural temperament that I have people do in some of our workshops, I'll ask them to write their name down a couple of times. And then once they've done that, I'll ask them to switch hands and do it again. That's a good analogy because the first time, your natural temperament, it feels right, it's easy, your results are consistent, you don't even have to think about it. Doing the same with your non-dominant hand or behaving in a way outside of your natural temperament, it doesn't feel natural, takes a lot more effort. It's not sustainable. If I asked you to do it for forever, it would be very difficult to do so. And if you did attempt to, it would become very stressful. So we just want to take note of that as we're learning about the individual we're recruiting and we're looking at their temperamental profile. So once you've assessed a candidate and you've given them a McQuaig word survey, the McQuaig system can provide you with an assessment of job fit. And that's going to be based on the candidate profile and the job profile that you created when you defined the requirements for the role. This section is actually particularly important when you're recruiting. And the next section of the assessment of job fit, what it shows you is the level of match between the individual and the benchmark that you've created. So here we have an account executive profile compared to this individual, Justin Weaver. And again, we see those gray T-bars on the account executive. Those are indicative of where we're going to consider a candidate a strong match if they fall. Our system works out a bunch of, works on their algorithms and comes up with a level of match. So Justin Weaver, it turns out, is a strong match for this position of account executive as we've defined it. The McQuaig report goes on to give you a more detailed analysis of that job fit. In Justin's case, he actually was a strong match on each trait scale, but you're going to see three things come up as the overall level of match. It's going to either be a strong match, potential match, or a does not match. Following this section of analysis of job fit, there's going to be a whole section of a strengths analysis as well as a gap analysis with some suggested interviewing questions to help you further explore the gaps as well as the strengths of an individual. You're not always going to, if somebody comes back as a potential match, you're not going to disregard their application and take them out of the running, but the McQuaig system is really going to help you to identify the areas where you're going to want to dig a little deeper. You're going to be able to identify the areas where this person potentially will struggle based on the job that you defined and the temperament you defined as required for the role. So the McQuaig word survey, it includes, There's two sections to it, really, and this first section is very relevant to recruiting. The profile is going to give you which is that visual representation that we just looked at, the interpretation report that gives you a comprehensive and fundamental understanding of the assets that this individual is going to bring to the job, as well as possible areas for development or concern. Like I said earlier, there's no good or bad when it comes to temperament. Any trait that you have, it's going to come along with certain strengths as well as certain weaknesses. Next, if it's a leadership role, you can include a profile of this person's likely behaviors as a leader or in a sales role. Probably the most valuable sections of the report are the assessment of job fit. So it's going to tell us, based on the job profile we put together, is this person a strong match, potential match, or not a match, as well as some strong behavioral-based interviewing questions that we can use. So we've talked about how we can use the McQuaig system to define the roles within our organization and then assess our candidates against those. Now that McQuaig helped you to hire that fantastic candidate, what can you do to make sure that that person becomes a successful employee within your organization? Well, we have some tools to help you there as well. So it's an interesting thing to note. You know, your retention actually does start with your selection. Two-thirds of employees, they quit their boss, not their job. And so when we're recruiting, that's a big part of the fit that matters. A lot of that comes down to personality. When you hired your candidate, you gained a lot of valuable insight into their temperament and how they'd fit into the job based on the profile you created. Now that they are an employee, this information does still remain valid and helpful. So don't just tuck it away in a drawer, use it. Understanding the temperament of your new employee, that can give you important information to help you ensure that they're managed properly and that they're given tools and support that they need to be successful. So we went over the first section of the word survey and what that includes, all relevant for hiring. Now, once we've made a selection, the second part of the word survey becomes much more relevant. The management overview, it is a good snapshot for a manager to refresh their memory on their candidate's profile. Motivating factors is going to look at how an individual likes to be motivated on the job. The strategies for coaching and development is fantastic to give guidance on how to work with an individual effectively. It can also be really impactful if a manager has a copy of their own as well as the new employee. Actually share and look at each other's for this one. That can really create, especially if you have different profile types, can really help you create a strategy for dealing with one another, because when we do have different profile types, when I'm the complete opposite of somebody, there's a lot of potential for me and that person to butt heads and to not see eye to eye. However, diversity really is what makes us successful. And if we're completely different, well, you know what that means? It means that every single one of my weaknesses, that person has that as a strength, and vice versa. So if we're able to develop a strategy to work cohesively together, got a lot of potential to be a fantastic team, and McQuaig can really help to bring that team together. Developmental learning style report tells you about how that person best likes to learn. That should and could play a part in your onboarding strategy and any training. And the team approach report will talk about how that person is going to interact on a team, how they'd like to interact on a team. If we do have a team of individuals that we're working with, then let's use that in the team integration. So when should you use the McQuaig system? Here's our recommended approach. We say that prior to the screening interview, you should complete the job survey and ensure that you have a strong job profile benchmark that you're happy with. And then during the screening interview, you can use the job survey questions to help screen your candidates. Those questions are customized based on the job profile you've determined is necessary. After the screening interview, that's when you should administer the word survey. there's a lot of content in the word survey that can help to guide your interview. So you want to do it early in the process. As soon as you've screened your candidate, at that point you've determined that they've got, you know, the level one and two characteristics that you need. Let's administer the word survey because we know they're a viable candidate, and let's bring them in for an interview. And then when once they're in front of you for an interview and all of your subsequent interviews, now you can use the word survey report as well as the job the interview guide questions to help guide you through that interview. And then finally, once they're hired, you're going to use the word survey report to help with things like onboarding, with conflict resolution, with team approach, training planning, etc., etc. And then 6 to 12 months post-hire, we would recommend that you use the McQuaig self-development survey for coaching and development. People often ask us how heavily they should weigh the McQuaig in the selection process, and our answer to them is actually is a very important piece. It's not the whole puzzle, but it is an important piece. If somebody comes back as a does not match, your temperament, your personality, as we saw earlier in this presentation, it's actually highly predictive of what your on-the-job performance is going to look like. So do give it a good chunk of weight in your interview process. One thing that might strike you on this slide, and it's interesting because more than half of you said that your hiring managers base their decisions on level two assessment. That's education and experience. That's the smallest piece of the pie. Those are things that are prerequisites. We're not even going to consider somebody. If we've got five candidates we're considering, all of them have sufficient education and experience to even be in front of us. That's a given. The difference between candidate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that actually should be given a very small piece of the pie. It's not that highly predictive of how they're going to perform on the job. Rather, all of the other pieces tend to be much more important. So we're about to wrap up. A few key points that I do want you to walk away with. You want to consider level one and level two attributes. Absolutely, those are kind of your prerequisites. But really delve into the level three attributes. That's where somebody either becomes a star employee or somebody that you end up terminating. So make sure that you do a good job really getting into the level three attributes. Facilitate a decision-making process amongst the hiring team to ensure that there's clarity and consistency so that we know what we want, what are we looking for. And we do that through the job survey as well as the job analysis. Make sure that we're all on the same page so that when we are looking for candidates, we're looking for the right thing, the same thing. Structure your interview process and apply it equally to all candidates. So you need to look at them through a common lens, absolutely. One thing that you'll find in the job fit interview guide, all of the interview questions in there are the same, and that's a big part of looking at your candidates through the same lens. They need to be asked the same questions to be given the opportunity to answer them so we can rank them. We can be objective about this. Use behavioral interview techniques to truly understand the candidate, getting the straight goods. If we're not using strong behavioral interviewing questions, we're getting answers that are our candidates telling us what we want to hear rather than what have you actually done in the past. Tell me about that. Tell me about that achievement. This is the only way that we'll get to a lot of those level three characteristics because some of them are impossible to assess through any kind of tool like McQuaig, something like an individual's maturity, for example. So make sure you're using strong behavioral interviewing techniques. Right. And once on board, play to their strengths. Everybody has, no matter what your temperament is, there is no good, no bad, but we're all going to have strengths. We're all going to have weaknesses. Play to their strengths and use the McQuaig self-development survey to help help them develop those strengths, and to also mitigate some of their weaknesses. Great, and that's our webinar for today. Do we have any questions? If you do have a question, you should see a text box at the bottom of your GoToWebinar screen, and there you should be able to type your question in there. Okay, I do have a question regarding whether or not I can share the slides. I absolutely can, but I don't have your email address listed here right now, so I just put up my contact information. If you would like the slides, please just email me and I'll get them to you. And I'm sorry I have such a long last name that you have to copy down. Do we have any other questions? Okay, I don't see any other questions coming in. If any of you do have anything that you'd like to ask or talk about one-on-one, you can definitely get in touch with us here at the McQuaig Institute. We'd be happy to talk to you. You can call or email. And I do hope that you all found today's webinar helpful. Have an excellent day, everybody.